I started in my ministry as a youth pastor back in 1987 in Houston, Texas. And I remember there were about 50 to 60 high school students in the group, and the original leader, the before me previous leader, had burned out, though he'd done some good work. They were a rowdy bunch. They were distracted. They were not into what was going on up front, either the worship or the speaking. And I remember being there the first time. I wanted to get up and just yell at them, and I realized that wasn't the way to correct the problem. In fact, that's what the previous guy had tried to do, and it just didn't work. So I knew I had to keep praying and waiting and smiling, and I knew I needed to keep loving them and just keep pointing the way to God and focusing on God and hoping that they would come with me to experience God's presence. Well, a few months after I got there, I led a mission trip into Mexico with about 25 of the students, and our yellow school bus broke down along the way. And so we had to spend the night in a little motel in Monterrey, Mexico. And it was a disaster because we had to drag all these huge suitcases and attic trunks and all these things, especially the girls brought, off the bus. But it led to a miracle breakthrough the next morning. While they were fixing the bus, we had our first Bible study of the trip. And we all crowded into a little room, a little motel room there in Monterrey. And as we began our first worship time, they were all leaning toward God because of the mission trip, enough to just try and sing the songs together. And since we were so crowded, so packed into this little motel room, they actually heard each other's voices, and they loved it. From ninth grade on up to the leaders and all of us, we loved what we heard. And so for the rest of the trip, when it was time to worship, everybody sang loud and everybody loved it. And it was much more than the music. You see, it was the united faith in our voices that brought a sense of the presence of God, even for high school students. And so when we got back to Houston, this group became the hot coals for worship that lasted for the 7 years that Lynn and I were there. Every Wednesday night at our regular meeting, they made it the thing to do. They just led out with passion, and everybody else deferred for that 20 minutes or however long it was. And that sense of that sound of the voices and the united faith, it brought a strong awareness of God. And it became that prime time, we called it, became the highlight of the week for many of us for 7 years. We've been talking about this in the last few weeks. We've been looking at the Psalms to understand God's presence. Scott spoke on Psalm 23 last week. About 3 weeks ago, I started on Psalm 84. And so from even the Old Testament, we were seeing the passion and the excitement for the presence of God, seeking to learn about it. And we're realizing that's the key to worship and our experience on Sunday morning just becoming so much more wonderful. Is simply the word presence. Not my presence, not whether I've had a good week or not, not whether I feel like I deserve to experience this or not, not whether I even want to come or not, not which song or which sermon I like or which preacher or which worship leader I like or don't like, no. Not my presence. Not our presence, not even whether we like each other or not, not even whether we're social or not. Thank God the key to our Sunday morning is not me, it's not you, it's not us, it's Jesus. And when we come, just like we sang, it's provided by grace for sinners, thanks to the cross. And that lifts us up. And so we may come tired, we may come in here failing, we may come in here struggling and confused, and then we experience Jesus, because it depends on him, not you, not me, not us. It's the presence of God. It's the presence of Jesus. This was certainly true for Palm Sunday, right? On that first Palm Sunday when Jesus triumphantly entered Jerusalem on the donkey, and they waved the branches and they sang and they said, Hosanna to the King. They weren't excited about themselves or each other in the crowd. They didn't even know each other. They were excited about the one coming into Jerusalem. And you know what? His people still get excited about him when they gather together. And he is here. For all of us who have faith If you know that, sing loud when it's time to worship. And we'll hear your voice better than any amplification, better than any instruments. That's why we have the music. That's why we do the preaching. And if you join in with your voice and say, I believe that, I want that spirit, that sense of God's presence, I want to be excited about him, you'll help bring that with your voice, even if you can't sing very well. And if you sit by me and you hear my loud voice and that offends you, just drown me out with your own loud voice. So to continue to understand this presence that we seek that's so important to our service and this becoming a highlight of the week for us, we returned to Psalm 84 where we were 3 weeks ago, and there was a Levite there, a son of Korah, a priest, a singer, a worker in the temple. Again, this is in the Old Testament. It's a very inferior experience compared to what we can have in the New Testament. But even this man was so excited in writing Psalm 84 about how wonderful the presence of God was. And we looked at that a few weeks ago, and he described it as being lovely. He described it as being home for him, like a nest for the sparrow. He described it as being empowering or strengthening in the journey and the effort that we have to make to experience the presence of God. It's so empowering. We go from strength to strength. And finally, he described it as comforting, God's presence stronger than our grief and pain. Well, as we continue this message today, we see two final adjectives in the psalm that he uses to describe God's presence. And the first one is, God is attentive. God is attentive. He's attentive. And this comes out in verse 8. The adjective is here. Hear my prayer, O Lord God Almighty. Listen to me, O God of Jacob. Again, we're just going to be looking at two verses this morning. So let me read it again. Let the words sink in. These are the words of God. Hear my prayer, O Lord God Almighty. Listen to me, O God of Jacob. All right? Now, let me come down here, shock us, and let y'all get out of the lights here just for a minute. All right, everybody wake up. We've been trying to talk about the difference between the presence of God and the manifest presence of God. The manifest presence of God is not just that God's everywhere, but that he's here in a special way to change all of us. So there's a difference between me and you being in the same room and me talking with you, right? So, Jim Fetzer, how you doing this morning?
Great.
Awesome. What have you been getting out of the sermon so far? I'm just kidding. I'm not quizzing you, not trying to put you on the spot. I just wanted to call your name. What's that? Sing loud. Oh, that's good. All right. I give you an A plus. All right. Dave, how are you doing this morning? Aren't you glad you came to church?
I am.
Yeah, well, I'm just glad to be able to talk with you before you sneak out of here and don't say hi to me. So it's good to see you here today.
Good to see you too, brother.
Awesome. All right.
Keep up the good work.
Okay. Now, y'all see the difference between just you and me here in the room and me calling your name, having a little bit of a personal conversation with you? That's the difference between God and 7 billion other people just being in the same world. And between God calling your name and by faith you sensing that he is listening to you, it'll change you forever. God becomes personal. Or for us, we're here together, he becomes like, he's like right here in the room and he's listening to our singing, he's listening to our sermon, he's speaking right now to us individually. That is the manifest, not just the omnipresent God existing in the world. No, this is the God that's manifested in the temple. And now the temple, the veil is torn, and Jesus is making this available now for us as one local expression in the Church of Jesus Christ. So I want y'all to catch that attentive presence, the attentive presence. God is listening. Hear me. Listen to me, the psalmist says. Is he? Is he? Yes. Is he listening right now? Does he listen to us when we pray? Yes. Should that be amazing? Yes. I get flustered when I realize this. You see, in this verse, it calls God the Lord Almighty, or it's also the Lord of hosts. Literally, it's the Lord of armies, the Lord of angels. which calls to mind his power and his sovereignty, or simply the fact that it's within his control or his power to give or to withhold all that is good in the universe. And he's listening to you and to me. And he has that much to give. If this dawns on you, you'll want to talk to him way more than you want to talk to other people. Okay? So, it makes me, again, get flustered. The key statement, we should want to talk with God more than anyone else when we realize that he is listening. I remember getting an appointment with Frank Batten, who owns the Virginian Pilot. I don't know if you're aware of that. It's a big newspaper in the Tidewater area, Virginia Beach, Norfolk, Chesapeake. And the man who owned that came to our service a few times. And one summer, they had a beach cottage, and so they came and sort of very low-key, you know, but we heard they were there and that they had enjoyed us at least for that one summer. And one of our elders knew him personally. So when we started our first capital campaign to buy land, you know, next to the interstate to then build a church, the elder and I got an appointment with Frank Batten. I'll never forget, I was so nervous. And I got to make my pitch and I had a brochure. And as a result of our time with him, by God's grace, Frank gave us $500,000 just to get started in our campaign. And I don't know if you ever think this way, but if there's somebody important in your life to your goals, and you just think, man, if I could get an appointment with them and I could make my little pitch to them. And I want to say, if we had any idea who's already listening, who we already have an appointment with every day, thanks to Jesus Christ, we would talk. We would make that time a priority. We would give our best before him. He's listening. Are you kidding? The Lord, he's like stopping all of heaven in his glory in the throne room. And he's like able to do, I don't know how he does this, but he's listening to each one of us as if we were the only person in the world. And he's like, go ahead. You have my full attention. You are my child. I am so glad you're here. I'm predisposed to bless you. What do you want? Jesus asked the question all the time on the earth. What do you want? You have no idea how important the answer to that question is, given who's asking it. And that's the sense of his presence. Right now, God is listening. Who cares what else matters? Let's talk to him. Let's bring our requests before him. I want to give two quick examples from the Old Testament. Again, doorkeepers, people who couldn't go into God's presence like we can, but who took great advantage of the attentive presence of God. The first is King Solomon. And the example comes in 1 Kings 3 when Solomon had just, as a young man, been made king over God's people. And he says in verse 5 of 1 Kings 3, it says there, at Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon during the night in a dream. And God said, ask for whatever you want me to give you. Okay, there it is, the attentive presence of God is coming now. And we think that, oh my gosh, that's amazing. I would never have that kind of opportunity. And yet we have a much greater opportunity than he did because he's just a doorkeeper in the Old Testament. But here it was, he was a king of Israel, just a young man. God comes to him in a dream and says, ask me whatever you want to do for you. And Solomon responded that he was only a little child who had been placed over a great people, too numerous to count. And so he asked God for a discerning heart to govern God's people and to distinguish between right and wrong. And do you know what the result was of that simple response, that prayer that Solomon gave to God in that moment? The Lord was so pleased that Solomon had asked for this. He did not ask for long life or wealth for himself or the death of his enemies like typical kings would have in his position, but he asked for discernment and the ability to administer justice. And so God was so moved. In fact, he was so pleased that he gave Solomon what he asked for, like he never gave wisdom before and never gave it again. He made him such a wise king that Solomon wrote thousands of proverbs and has been known as the wisest king ever. But then he said he also gave him what he didn't ask for, riches and honor, so that there would be no equal among kings to Solomon. And that blows me away. You see, what we learned from Solomon's experience in the attentive presence of God is ask God for something really good. If you know he's listening, ask for something that will impress him, and he'll give you all the other things. Ask for something that will bless God, and he'll give you that and many other things that will bless you as well. That's what we learn from Solomon, a doorkeeper in the presence of God. We can walk right in thanks to the name of Jesus, the access that Jesus gives us. We come in, we ask God for something good, for something that would please God, that would bless God. And then watch how he responds. He'll give you so much more. And that. And the second example is a widow in one of the prophets of a widow of one of the prophets of Elisha. He had a team of prophets, and her husband died. The story is in 2 Kings 4, verses 1 through 7. When her husband died, she became very poor. The creditors were coming to take her two boys away and make them slaves. And so in desperation, she cried out to Elisha, the head prophet, for help. All she had in her house was a small jar of olive oil. Okay, so Elisha responded in verse 3 of 2 Kings 4. Go around and ask all your neighbors for empty jars. Don't ask for just a few. Then go inside and shut the door behind you and your sons. Pour oil into all the jars, and as each is filled, put it to one side. She left him and shut the door behind her and her sons. They brought the jars to her, and she kept pouring. When all the jars were full, she said to her son, "Bring me another one." But he replied, "There is not a jar left." Then the oil stopped flowing. She went and told Elisha, and he said, "Go sell the oil and pay your debts. You and your sons can live on what is left." All right, what do we learn from her? From Solomon, we learn, ask for something good. But from the widow, we learn, ask for a lot of things every day. Again, let me remind you, these are doorkeepers. We might say, well, I'm not King Solomon, or I don't know a miracle-performing prophet like Elisha. I don't have access to a man of God like that. Well, you have access. We have access to the Lord Jesus Christ. And we don't just have one opportunity to bring our expectation before God's generosity. We can bring our expectation to God's attentive presence every day. Every day. And then the door shuts. And then there is a finale, because you see, we can't ever use today. We'll never have today again to pray all kinds of things. And the door does shut on that. And so what are you praying for today? God is listening. What are you asking? What are you asking for? Ask for a lot of things. Ask for good things. This is our response to the attentive presence of God. Okay, next, we've got to hurry. God's presence is not only attentive. The second and final characteristic of God's presence that the psalmist closes with in Psalm 84 is God's presence is superior to any other presence, to any other place we could be. Our presence, your presence, my presence in the world. God's presence is by far superior. And here's the famous verses 10 and 11 of Psalm 84. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. These are just sounds from thousands of years ago, from a very inferior experience of God's presence, but it's saying something to us. We who have the Lord Jesus Christ and a greater experience of the Lord's presence, saying, that is so much better. That is so far superior to any other presence. Okay, so just brought two pens, start this off. Randomly, this is a Mont Blanc, and this is a Bic pen, but whatever. Let's just say this pen is better than 1,000 of these pens. Are you tracking with me? This pen is better, not equal to, it's better than 1,000 of these, all right? And that's what the psalmist is saying. One day with Jesus is better than 1,000 anywhere else. 1,000. I don't know what you think of the world, what you think of yourself, what you think of some other individual person, but it's vastly inferior to Jesus. and the experience that you would have with him. And this has to go deep in our hearts, deep in our souls. Jesus is better. The presence of God is better by more than 1,000 times. More than 1,000 times better. Son of Korah says, oh, better is one day. And so God comes to the basic unit of our life, the day, and he blesses it. He makes it that much more significant, that much better, just one day, and then he puts another day with it and another day with it, and pretty soon our life is vastly superior to someone else or to us if we were anywhere else. This is not because of us, it's because of him. In our day-to-day experience. You know, movies get ratings, especially, I think I'm familiar with the 5-star rating system, so a 5-star movie is awesome, right? You know, there are actually 0-star movies. Paid for all kind of money, did work, and it turned out to be 0-star. Have you ever watched a 0-star movie? And the only reason you keep watching it is you think, it has to get better. Can't be this bad. And you get all the way to the end, and you're like, it was that bad all the way. Why are they putting this on TV? Why did I pay money to go see this? Zero-star movie. I remember Dad and I, years ago, went to see a Clint Eastwood movie. At the time, it was called Firefox. Great movie. And the theater we went to, there was a power failure, so we were already, like, frothing at the mouth to see a movie. And so we've got to see a movie, and went over to another theater, and the only thing playing was a movie called Tron. I don't know if you like that movie, but for us, it was a disaster. They fall into a computer, and the whole movie takes, it's not even real, it's not even realistic. And so we got to the end of the movie, and I remember my dad sitting there, just as it was over, he says, then came those blessed words of relief, the end. A 0-star movie. Reminds us just how good and how bad a movie can be, and the same is true with our days. A day outside of God's presence is like a 0-star movie. Even if you like it, even if you're excited about it, you have to accept the fact from God's word that you could have had something 1,000 times better, at least 1,000 times better, if you had been in the presence of God, if you had asked him for help, if you had trusted him and been aware of him and leaned on him to come flowing through you, and the difference that would be compared to being away from him in the world. No matter what you think of that, there's something 1,000 times better for your day. We experience a superior or an inferior life one day at a time. And sometimes we come to the end of our day and we get in bed and we think, then came those blessed words of relief, the end. Have you ever had days like that? I know I have. In fact, I have a deep sorrow in my heart for all the days I've lived that could have been 1,000 times better, but no more. No more wasting that which could be so valuable. You know, it's not just for us. This is a presence that we can bring to the world. This is a presence that we take with us. So we give people so much more than ourselves. We give them Jesus. We give them not just us, but we give them this experience of this presence. It's not just for us. It flows to other people. It's reflected to other people. And so we can bring this to other people. Now, I want you to imagine you're on The Voice, okay, the TV show The Voice. It's kind of like American Idol. They're judging people for their ability to sing and entertain. I don't know if you've seen it. But let's imagine that we're watching an episode together, and let's say the contestants are really good. In fact, some of them are finalist material on that show that particular night. So the crowd's already been cheering and very impressed. And now I want you to imagine with me that the last contestant who takes the stage is 1,000 times better than the others that have come so far. They are 1,000 times more talented, more poised, more passionate, more charismatic, more engaging, more entertaining, more creative, more inspirational. Their voice has 1,000 times the tone quality, the range. Imagine the effect on the audience when that candidate is through singing. And you will be imagining your effect in an inferior world. in a world that's 1,000 times more inferior than the presence of Jesus Christ. When you and I walk in the world, that's what it can be. It's not just for us that we have a day that's 1,000 times better. We walk in and the presence we bring is 1,000 times better than the king of the world, than the best actor, the best musician, the best business leader, the best political leader, the best looking, richest, most famous person in the world. We can be 1,000 times better than them. So says the Word of God. Because we bring the presence of Jesus Christ. It's not just for us to experience, it's for us to bring into the world with confidence, a superior presence. So the Levite says, I would rather be a doorkeeper in this presence than dwell in the tents of the wicked. I would rather be a poor man in God's presence than be the king or the queen of Vanity Fair. I'd rather sell popcorn and shine shoes in God's presence than be loved and adored by millions of people anywhere else. Okay, so given this potential now, we'll close with two phrases that we need to say. And as I've experienced this, I found these two phrases to be filled with the Spirit for me. As I journey to this greater, superior presence, this attentive presence, especially the superior presence, I find that I just want to say these short, brief, simple phrases from my heart. Okay, the first phrase we say to Satan every day, and it's simply, no way. Okay, if you get that the presence of Jesus is superior to the world or any other presence, then you need to be ready, waking out of bed in the morning, to say to Satan, I'm already going to start a conversation with you, Satan, first thing in the morning, and I just wanted to tell you, no way. All right, so the verse that we read is contrasting two things. There's the courts, God's courts, and there's elsewhere. There's the house of my God, and there are the tents of the wicked. There's two options. There's not a neutral option where I'm not like, I'm really bad, but I'm not really close to God. It's like, no. You're either in the presence of God that he's lovingly provided, or you're somewhere else. There's just two options. So we have to recognize that we have to make the effort to be in God's presence, or by default, we're like a dairy product outside the fridge. We're like sour cream that's not in the refrigerator. Forever long that we're not consciously saying, Lord, I need you, please help me. I trust you, I'm aware of you. Then now we're in the fridge and we're gonna be our best. We're gonna be in that 1,000 times better presence. But the minute we move from that, we begin to spoil. We begin to degenerate down to something so inferior, even though we may not be able to see it. We may be deceived from that, not even realizing it. So in that process, the devil's there every day trying to get us to leave God's presence because that scares him. We do not scare him. God scares him. Jesus scares him. So when we're in the presence of Jesus, he's scared. So he's trying everything he can do to move us away from Jesus. Get away from Jesus. Get away from Jesus. Then I got you. And so he's coming at us with all kinds of temptations. And that's simply the way to recognize it. Are you asking me to move away from the presence of God, from the presence of Jesus? And as soon as you do, no way. And so we have a conversation, waking up in the morning. It goes like this. Before the offer comes, I just want to say, Satan, the answer is no. I don't care how much you hype it. I don't care how good you make it look. I'm not going there. You're asking me to give up something at least 1,000 times better, and I won't do it, not today. If you say that, you'll find the Holy Spirit helping you, and that'll help your experience of God's presence to be preserved. It's not just the sin that we experience and its horrible consequences. It's the superior presence that we're missing. And that should make us want to say, no way, thief, no way, destroyer. You're not taking me to ruining even one day that I could be experiencing with Jesus. This is a very personal thing for each one of us. We've got to believe that good is better than evil, and that being in God's presence is at least 1,000 times better than being anywhere else our sin might take us. And so we have to say to Satan every day, no way. I don't care what you put in front of me. You know my weaknesses. You know what I like. No way. The second phrase that we'll say in the power of the Spirit, and this one we don't say to Satan, but we say it to this inferior world. We say, so what? In the classic movie Fight Club, I don't recommend you watch it. It's not an enjoyable movie or a good movie, but it's intense. It stars Brad Pitt and Edward Norton. A group of men are so fed up with the world, they join a club where they beat each other up just to feel better. And then they hug each other afterwards with their broken noses and their bloody faces and their bruises and their cuts, and somehow they feel better. And then Brad Pitt, who portrays the leader of this club, takes the men purposely into life-threatening situations and then asks them, and this is the brilliance of the whole movie, why do you want to live? While their life is on the edge. He goes, why do you want to live? Is it to get a job you don't like, to pay for things you don't need? You are not what's in your bank account. You are not the size of your house. It's a very powerful movie. And the reason I like it is because the men in the club are looking at the world and they're saying, so what, world system? And they're not even able to exchange it for anything except some subversive group that goes around blowing things up to make their point, which of course I don't advocate. I just like a group of men that are getting the fact that the world stinks compared to what they could have, and it must be out there somewhere. And even just that much is a relief to so many people who are experiencing the emptiness of this world. There's something so much better. And deep in our hearts, we have to say, so what? A friend of mine in Virginia Beach, a guy named Bryce Mahoney, different guy, love him, but he's just a little offbeat from the world in a refreshing way. He talked to me one day about an opportunity he had to share with some people in the Charlotte airport. And so he's telling me this story. I'm not surprised it's Bryce, but he said, yeah, you know, there's a bunch of us were waiting for a delayed flight, and I began talking with a few of them about relationship principles, and they were interested, so more began listening, and before I knew it, the whole waiting area was bored with nothing else to do, and so they were all tuning into me, and I started to speak to the whole room, and he said, I shared my faith. I actually shared the gospel about how Jesus could forgive all their sins, and he was getting all excited. He had a lot of difficulties in his life, and this was one of his bright spots. And I'm thinking, to be honest, I'm thinking, Bryce, not an airport. No. Don't. Why not? Well, because there's a certain stigma that goes with that. You're one of those crazy people. Says who? Well, the people will think you're a fool. What people? People from the world system. A system that doesn't ultimately satisfy, a system that is vastly inferior, will think you're stupid. So don't do it. Hide Jesus for people you don't even know, strangers, and what they might think of you. Yeah, defer to them instead of to Jesus, who's at least 1,000 times better. And we just need to say, so what? God is a God who cares for things. He has great compassion, but there is also a great deal that he does not care about and needs to help us not care about. Because you see, we only have a certain amount of our heart, and if we care so much about the world and what they think, we don't have much left over to care about what's 1,000 times better. And we need it all for what's the best. So we have to say, so what to the world? At so many levels, so what? So I'll end with this. Let's make a list and say it every day, but we can get started this morning, so what? And feel deep in our spirit, God helping us say this and really mean it. Okay, I'll just do 5 sentences, and if you feel it in your heart and you want to say it, say with me at the end, so what, okay? Just repeat after each phrase with me. If God puts it in your heart, just say, so what? Okay, so here's the first phrase. Something we try to do for God may fail, making us look bad to some people. So what? Could we say it a little louder?
So
Good. Second one, if we share our faith with others, some may respond, but others may think we're crazy. Oh, what? If we follow Jesus, our lives may not turn out the way we thought they would. So what? If we give our children to the Lord, God's call on their lives may cause us to live in different places in the country or the world. If we really get into God, he might ask us to do things that are scary and exhausting. Okay, that's just a little start. And there's like a million other ones for you. I'm a men pleaser, and I have to say this over and over again. So what? For something so much better to land there with my whole heart. Well, in conclusion, let me just say as we transition to the worship time, this superior presence has a name. It's not just God's presence. It's the presence of Jesus. And we're celebrating him especially on Palm Sunday. One day with him is better than 1,000 without him. So the worship team now is going to lead us in a new song, a brand new song we heard in Nashville that just brought many of us to tears, that just asked the question, is he worthy? Isn't he this wonderful? And it's a chance for us all to be reminded of the amazing, superior presence, not just of God, but of our Lord Jesus Christ. So let's let them now lead us in this new song, and then they'll also sing Better as One Day before we take communion.
Lion of Judah, I mean, I do look at this world and see how broken it is. And even Dean's words this morning of reminding us that we can bring God's presence wherever we go.
In every situation that we deal with, that God is there.
And that he is the healer of everything,
every situation that you sit back and you think, God, how could you work in this? There's no way. He can change lives beyond anything that we can imagine. And to be in his presence and have the honor of again, making him king, just like 2,000 years ago, so many people stood before him and laid down those palm fronds and called him Lord and King, Hosanna to the highest. That's what we get to do, even in this moment. So let's stand together, and we're going to sing this song, Better Is One Day, together.
My soul longs and even
This is the part in our service where we remember the death of Jesus, and in light of our message this morning, none of these Old Testament saints, not the Psalm writers, not Solomon, not Elijah, Elisha, David, Moses, Hannah, these godly people who loved God, who experienced God, even who went to heaven without dying, they were so much caught up with God. None of them could go into the manifest presence of God like we can. All right? And the reason is not because we are better than them. Right? It's only because we live in the New Testament or the New Covenant period, and they were in the Old Testament. And that means it's because of Jesus, not because of us. It's because of what he did. He walked in to Jerusalem, and he realized in the temple was filled with greed, and he had to cleanse it, and a week later they put him on the cross. And we're going to celebrate that. We're going to remember that in a deep way on an annual level this Friday at our Good Friday service, and this Sunday when he rose from the dead. But when he did that, the veil in the temple that separated the people of God from the manifest presence of God was torn from the top to the bottom because of the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. Because he died to forgive our sin. Not because of what we've done, but because of what he did, we get to go into the manifest presence of God. And it's very important because many of us will stay out based on something we have done or can't do. Well, I don't know how to pray very well. I can't stop doing bad things. So I can't enjoy the presence of God. It's like, hey, the presence of God is not based on what you do, but on what Jesus did for you. You'll never be good till you come into his presence. You can come in thanks to the forgiveness, thanks to the access that Jesus provided when he died on the cross for you, for me. So you might look at somebody and you might say, hey, you're better than me. You look good. I'm not like you. No, you're not seeing us. If you think there's anything good in me or in any other Christian, you're not seeing them. You're seeing Jesus in the presence of Jesus. We are just weak and sinful people. And if we're ever good, it's because Jesus is there. So I want to tell you, you can have that presence by faith. And even now as we have communion, we're representing the sacrifice of Jesus, the bread, the wafer is his body they put on the cross. The cup is his blood that was shed, his life that was given. So we could deserve, so we could experience, so we could have the presence that would make us good. And so it's for sinners like you, like me, and maybe this morning you could have it for the first time and begin to experience the power of it and the beauty of it and the comfort of it. And you'll come home, you'll experience home, and you'll find it's vastly superior, and God will be listening to you, ready to do amazing things based on what you ask him. And all of it is just simply you say, thank you, Jesus, for forgiving my sin and opening the way for me to have this presence that will change me. None of us deserve that. And we only get it because of Jesus. So I'm thinking of that and celebrating that now as we remember Jesus, we take and hold the elements in our hands and we take them in. Make that personal for you and begin to experience the very presence that it represents. It will change you. It will give you better days, better days. I welcome you to the table. If you come in that way, would you participate and would you receive Jesus in your hearts like we're all doing this morning? Hold the elements and we'll partake in just a few minutes once we've all been served.
Sinners and been redeemed, take your place.
That Jesus was betrayed, he was there in the upper room with his disciples, and there at the table before them, he took the bread, and he had blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to all of them. He told them, this bread is my body that's broken for you. Then after that, he took the cup from the table, and he passed it to them, and he told them, this is my blood that's shed for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Every time we eat of this bread and we drink of this cup, we remember the Lord's death until he comes again. Come time of the service for our offering, but I know it's been a very serious day, but I got to remind you guys that when Dean said that Tron is a bad movie, I like, all of us in the back, we all freaked out. We're like, no, Tron is like one of the greatest movies that has ever been written. I mean, like, it was like, come on, like, okay, sorry, yeah, couldn't help it, yeah, just great. But, so we need to educate Dean. So if you could give some extra money this week, that'll help us be able to buy a few more movies to show him the light that science fiction movies are great. No, all right, but seriously, though, again, for a day like this to, again, remember what God has done for us and have all these different opportunities to realize who he is and to go in his presence, it's so such a wonderful time for us to, again, be involved in the ministry here. And every time that we give, that's not only an offering to the Lord, but it continues to help us be able to do all the things that we need to do, again, to reach out into our community, to tell the people the truth of who Jesus is. So let's pray for our offering today, and again, that God would bless those efforts. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all that you do, all that you have done, and all that you continue to do, God. And we just thank you, Lord, for your son and the sacrifice that he has made. And we continue to sacrifice even of the fruits that you have given us, God, because they are ultimately yours in the first place. We thank you. Pray that you put a special blessing on everyone, Lord, today. And we just love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right. And we want to highlight just a couple of things that are in your bulletin today. It's Easter week, guys. Can you believe it? It's already here. So we have so many amazing things going on both here at the Academy and for the church this week. So first of all, we want to tell you to come back tonight at 6 p.m. for our special guests, Jews for Jesus, to present Christ in the Passover. They will be educating on all the elements of the Passover meal, and there'll be some praise music, so that'll be a great time. We hope to see you there. And then the next thing is this Wednesday is Shadow Day for our Fairfield Christian Academy. This is a really great day where your child, if they are not enrolled in the academy, or somebody you may know, a neighbor or a grandchild or whoever who might be interested in the academy, it's a day that they can register to come and follow a student around here at the academy and really get to see what a day at FCA is like. So we really encourage you to spread the word about that. And then, of course, Friday night, we'll see you back here at 7 p.m. for our Good Friday service. We have a really special service planned. It'll be really focused on the cross and communion. And then Easter Sunday, we have our two services at 9 and 10:30, and we really want you to invite somebody. It doesn't matter, just one person, anybody. It can be your hairdresser. It can be a random person you see in the grocery store. Invite them to come to sit with you on Easter Sunday, and we would love to see you all here. With that, we're going to worship our way out.
Let's go ahead and stand together.
Our God, a firm foundation, our rock. rest of my days. But the truth is I don't know where I let you go and lost my way. Said it would never happen, then walked at the door, yeah, once again. Can't even start to imagine a life without you.